guys, how you doing? Nick Jennison from Guitar Interactive and GI Plus. I say this every week because it's still true every week. I could have jammed on that all day. Hey, thanks for joining me. It is Monday evening. We're doing the thing that we do on Monday evenings, which is hang out and talk about the guitar. And we are continuing our discussion on the expressive vocabulary of some of the great guitar players of our era. Last week, we looked at Jimi Hendrix. This week, we are looking at the inimitable Brian May. Now, let me get straight out and say, no one does Brian quite like Brian. He's a very idiosyncratic guitar player, and that's what we love about him. But we can absolutely learn a thing or two from doing a closer examination into Brian May's style, into his touch, into his technique. We're not going mega deep nerd on the tone today. I'm going to show you some tricks about how you might get the tone, but we're not going like full-on rig examination today. It's more about Brian's touch, about his technique, about some of the lines that he likes to play maybe. We'll touch on all that stuff, but for the time being, I want to thank you very much for joining us. If you were a first-time viewer, hey, it's great to have you. Thanks for coming along. We do this every Monday, 8 p.m. UK time. It says so down here. Couple of things, a little bit of housekeeping before we get stuck into it. If you are enjoying what we're doing today and you want to help us keep the lights on, metaphorically and literally, a couple of ways you can do it. You can share this with your guitar playing friends. So we'd love to get this out to as many guitar players as we can. Give us a share. We'd greatly appreciate it. If you think you have a guitar player in your life that would enjoy what we're doing, then share this. We also have a whole backlog of streams you guys can go over where we talk about the expressive vocabulary of the likes of John Sykes. Who else have we done? Peter Green, Rory Gallagher, you name it, right? Great guitar players, one and all. We've got a couple of really killer ones coming up. Steve Vai, we've done two, who happens to rate Brian May. One of his all-time favorite guitar players. Yngwie Malmsteen, we've got coming up. We've got some Van Halen coming up. We've got Gary Moore coming up. You name it. So a couple of ways you can do that. A couple of ways you can help us keep the lights on. You can share this with your guitar playing friends. You can go to this URL down here to get some more guitar lessons, such as the one that we're going to be discussing as part of our study today. We have a tech session on Brian May done by Jamie Humphreys, no less. I'll show you that in just a minute. Jamie is one of those guys that knows an awful lot about Brian, and he's a nice dude too. So we can check that out a little bit later on. Also, you can go to, if you're not subscribed already, subscribe to us on YouTube so we can let you know when we are about to go live. So that's the housekeeping out of the way. Let's check in with the stream. Let's see who is in the house. We'll see who's in the house and we'll see what everybody's been up to this week. So let me just close down a couple of windows real quick. There we go. We're on live TV, folks. Okay. Hank Stane's in the house, says, hi all. Don't say I'm first. Hank, you are first. You have won the race to be first this week. We have a race among some of our regular attendees, our regular friends of the stream, who kind of race to be the first one through the door. And Hank Stane says, don't say I'm first. You are first, Hank. Could Nick be Brian's brother? They do look similar. It's the family haircut, Hank. That's the thing. No, unfortunately not. Although Brian May is very, very cool, and we do have very similar hair, and we are similar heights. I think Brian's about 6'2". I am also about 6'2". I'm a little less smart than Brian, though. Brian, astrophysicist, and I am not. I'm just a guitar player. Brian, guitar player and astrophysicist. And all sorts of other things too, and he owns all of the badges in the UK, or so I'm told. Anyway, that's another story for another day, but yeah, thanks man, appreciate that. Brian May looks really cool. So that's a high compliment. Say regards Slayer says, hi guys, hi Nick. Marcin is late in at 7:30. Marcin's normally first through the door. Marcin, it's good to see you, thanks for joining us. Mark Crandall's in the house, says, hi guys, hey Nick, hope everyone is doing well. Doing really well man, really appreciate it. PJ's got a cool story about seeing Brian May live at Sevilla. Stamped on his harmonizer by mistake before heading out into the crowd. Ouch. Makes him human and awesome. Do you know what? Like, it happens to the best of us. If it happens to Brian May, it happens to everybody else too. And I bet he styled it out. I bet he made it awesome. Steve McDee says, hi everyone, looking forward to Brian May style. So good, it came in two comments. Steve, it's great to have you. Thanks for joining us. Mark Crandall saw Queen in the late 70s. Freddie was so entertaining and Brian the astrophysicist was spectacular. Such a fun show. I am very jealous. I would have loved to have seen Queen in the Pomp. Just a little bit too young. I was born in 1984, so just a wee bit too young, unfortunately, but I would have loved to have seen that. David Reese is in the house. Hi, David. Great to see you. Mark McNish says, good evening all. Really need made those practice templates, Nick, I'm in a bit of a rut. He's referring to one of our upcoming courses, which is practice templates. We'll talk about that a little bit later on. Of course, our latest course is expressive techniques, and the next one that's about to drop is picking strategies, and I'll tell you more about that next week when it lands. Ooh, I might have given the game away there, but that's fine. That's okay. I love you guys, so I can tell you this stuff. Keith MOF says, good evening, everyone. Keith, it's great to see you. Chris Brown is in the house. George GT Sturgeo is in the house. George, hey, man, great to see you. I think you're a first-time commenter. So, hey, man, thanks for joining us. Appreciate it. Say it with Godslayer. Did you guys remember to bring the penny to use as a pick? It is a sixpence, as Jim Harris rightly points out. Brian May still has sixpences minted for him by the Royal Mint, even though sixpence has been out of circulation for a very long time. I don't have a sixpence, and I couldn't find a 5p, which is the nearest thing in size, but I have a penny, which we're going to demonstrate a little bit later on. That's an important component, and we'll get to that. Blue Summerlin is in the house. Blue Summerlin, it's great to see you. What else do we have? What else do we have? Brian Wilson is in the house. I am Brian with a Y. Hey, we've got Brian's all around. Callan says, hi, any advice how to write Brian May-like guitar harmonies? I'm going to flag this up, right? This is a great question because that's something we can talk about. We'll talk about that in the Q&A section a little bit later on. So later on in today's stream, we're going to be doing some live Q&A, so I'm going to put that to the top of the list. That's a really great question. Toast and Jam 52, this first time for me too, please be gentle. Hey man, we love first time commenters. Thanks for joining us, I really appreciate it. George says, question, Nick, are you going to be using wet, dry, wet? I am not. I'm going to be using dry, dry, dry is what I'm doing because we're trying to emulate some of Brian's, I guess his earlier studio tones with what I'm doing here, which were bone dry, with just a little bit of like booth reverb bleeding into a microphone. And I think it was really cool. Now, Brian was famously quoted as saying that he didn't put any ambience on his studio guitars because he wanted them to exist in whatever your listening environment was. So we're going as dry as I can tolerate today. So it is dry, dry, dry. But wet, dry, wet is 100% the way to do it if you're doing it live. I do actually have a wet, dry, wet rig set up here, of all things. So I could conceivably do it, but we're not going to be doing too much of the delay as we go. Pete Bell is a first timer on the East Coast of the US. Pete Bell, it's great to see you, man. Appreciate you joining us. Philip Murray says, can you show how Brian applies vibrato on bent notes, please? Philip Murray, you have read my mind. That is going to be the, well, part of the meat of today's lesson. But before we do that, just want to take a minute and show you this. This is something that you guys are going to get as part of your GI Plus membership. And it is only one of about 80 tech sessions that we have. So many tech sessions. It's outrageous. This is the Brian May tech session. It's been brought to you by Jim. Humphreys, he's using a Red Special. I'm not using a Red Special. I'll explain why I've chosen this guitar out of all the ones in my arsenal in a minute. And then we're going to be taking a look at one of the licks in this tech session. It's kind of a study piece, but this is one of the tech sessions that you get. We have them on all sorts of artists. So we've got them on Paul Gilbert, Tosin Abasi, Larry Carlton. Who else? We have Jeff Beck, if I'm not mistaken. We have Hendrix. We have Eddie Van Halen, Rory Gallagher. You name it, right? If you look at John Petrucci, Zach Wilde, Yngwie Malmsteen, if there's Joe Bonamassa, if there's a guitar player you can think of, we have a tech session on them. This is the Brian May session. When we come back, we'll talk about Brian May's expressive vocabulary. So that's the Brian Maytag session. If you want to learn that whole piece, and you want an in-depth analysis of Brian's tone, of his rig, of his note choices, all that sort of stuff, from somebody who's actually played with Brian, that's Jamie Humphreys, you can get that at the URL that is currently covered up by this banner. Let me kill that just for a second. There we go. You can get it by going to this URL. GI Plus members get that included in their GI Plus membership, along with so much other stuff. So if you're thinking about signing up, hey, maybe today is the day. Who knows? Anyway, let's get stuck in for just a moment. We've got some Boston references. PJ says, sounds like Boston track at one point there, smoking. Now, there is some tonal similarity between Tom Scholz and Brian May, I think. There's something in those screaming mids that both those guys have going on. So I can hear where you're going at with that one, man. I can hear that. So anyway, let's get stuck in. So the first thing I want to talk to you guys about, I want to talk to you about the elephant in the room, which is the pick. So we're going to grab a lick, I'm going to teach you the lick, and then we're going to talk about playing with different picks, how you might get some of Brian's touch with a more conventional plectrum. Now, I did some videos for Victory recently on the V1 series of pedals. And I did the V1 copper. One of the tone examples we took a look at was a Brian May tone. And I tried playing it with a 5P, and it was quite convincing, but oh my goodness, what a pain. What a nightmare to play with. So we'll talk about maybe ways we can get somewhere close to that without kind of like sacrificing playing comfort, if that makes any sense. So let's go to the close-up cam. Here's our lick. And this is the first lick from our tech session. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to flip the backing track on real quick, and I'm going to teach you guys this lick. We're going to play it together. The first thing we're going to play is we're going to be in the key of G. So we're going to do one of Brian's signature sweeping bends to the major third. And this is something Brian does all of the time. It's super melodic. Think about the second note, but the first really important note in the Bohemian Rhapsody solo, for example. That's another really great example. Or maybe the first note in Hammer to Fall. It's not a bend, but it's still, it's that major third thing. But then we get that, that big major third bend. It's such a Brian thing to do. It's such a Brian interval. We'll get to that. So we're going to begin by bending from fret number 10. Hopefully this, you guys can see this. It's quite small, but we have a 10 here. We're going to bend from 10 up to the pitch of fret number 12, and then we're going to partially release it to the pitch of fret number 11 and bend it back up. And for this, I'm going to turn my attention to a question we had just a second earlier on, which is from Philip Murray, where Philip Murray was asking how Brian applies vibrato to bent notes. We're going to talk about it on this note. But first, let's actually get the note on the go. So there's our backing track. Guys, let me know if you can hear the voice and the guitar and the backing track okay. Drop me a comment, and I want to make sure that the levels are all right for you. I want to make sure you guys can hear everything that's going on here. So let's try our bend first of all. We're going to go like this. We're going to go. Let's try that again. One more time. So we have that full bend. And then our full release, or partial release rather, and then bend it back up to pitch. Now, this again is a very interesting Brian May-ism, because if we take this in isolation, if we take this in isolation with itself, we can use this as an excuse to take a peek at how Brian applies his vibrato. But we'll get to that in a moment. So with our bend, I want to show you some examples with different picks, right? So if I just play the very first part of this like this, phrase it all sorts of weird and wonderful different ways, but if we take a look at different plectra, the effect that different picks have on our tone, I want to compare the effect of a coin. Now, what I have here is a one pence piece, which is kind of the closest I could find to a sixpence. Sixpence has a serrated edge, so it's not exactly the same. A 5p would have been better, but I didn't have a 5p in my house, of all things. I was convinced I had one, because here's a fun fact for PRS players. A 5p is probably the best thing for locking and unlocking PRS locking tuners. So, I've dropped my penny. It is long gone. It's gone into the ether. Never mind. We'll come back to that. Let me see if I can find another. I'm certain I have a penny kicking around here rather than me digging around and finding that one. I'm absolutely certain I have a 5p. Ah, as if by magic, there's my 5p. Okay, fabulous. So we got a 5p. It's a pain to play with, but let's take a listen to the way it sounds, right? So I'm going to play with my 5p. I'm going to play. Big pain to play with, but it has a certain metallic something about it that we like. Let's compare that to my usual pick, which is a Tortex, Jazz Tortex. It's going to sound like this. Maybe not quite 100% Brian, but if we go to our coin, we get a little bit more of that honk on the attack. Now, that is very interesting. Now, we discussed a little while ago that it's probably not the best idea to dedicate yourself to playing with a coin unless you find that very, very comfortable. However, there are a few little tricks that we can use to get a little bit more Brian into our sound. So I'm going to get rid of this tab for just a second because we're going to play that together. We'll talk about the vibrato in a moment. So real quick, I want to show you this. This is a Dunlop Flow. Now, this is a plectrum with a lot of chirp. We've talked about plect chirp before, but that's the sound that the pick makes when it impacts the string. Now, there's our chirp. Here's Tortex. Doesn't have a whole lot of chirp to it. Here's the coin. Massive amounts of chirp. But what we can also do with this pick is we can take this pick and we can rotate it and play with its shoulder. Now, this is going to be a rounder surface. Now, because we have a chirpy pick, any chirpy pick will do. So I'm thinking like maybe a Derlin pick would be fine. But these flows are really, really good for that sort of thing. Not a huge fan of them most of the time, but they have a particular sound that I really like. It's very, very chirpy. If we play with this, it should bring us a little bit closer to our Brian tone. So very quickly, let's compare Tortex. Versus coin. Now the coin sounds way more convincing, but let's go to the flow. It's a bit closer, and if we play with the shoulder, we can get a little closer again. Now, this is an interesting facet as well I want to talk about with regards Brian's picking technique. Now, this is going to infiltrate everything that Brian, everything we talk about Brian's expressive style. So the picking technique is a very interesting one because if you've ever tried playing with a coin, it is almost impossible to play with any degree of pick rotation using a coin. It just doesn't really work. You can scrape, you can sort of get it, but especially with quite a small coin like this one, just doesn't really fly. So a flatter picking approach, I think that's what Brian's doing. So let's compare real quick. Here is an edge picking approach where we have a 45 degree angle on our coin pick. Quite difficult to maintain. However, if we play with a flat attack like we've just played there, well, that sounds a little more Brian and it feels a little more comfortable. So let's keep that in mind with our flat attack with the edge of our chirpy pick. It's not 100% the way there with the coin, but it's pretty close. So if we play with a very flat pick attack and we play with a chirpy sounding pick, we are kind of on a winner. So let's get away from that. Let's go back to our lick. We're going to go back to our lick and we're going to play through this together. So our first part of our lick is going to sound something like this. There's our backing track. So let's begin by playing. Let's let that roll back around for just a moment. We're going to play. Then we have a little bit of a pull off down there. We could play, we could pick it, but we're going to play it with a pull off. So far we have, and then we have a little hammer on figure that we can follow up with. So we can have, again, a very, very Brian statement. This big bend, this little hammer-on figure sounds really, really great too. We're going to play this together. So I'm going to play it a few times. I'm going to get you to play it after me. Let's shorten that backing track real quick. It's going to loop back around here. So with our flat pick, right, and our chirpy pick attack, we're going to get this. Let's try that again. We're going to play. Now, how are we going convert that somewhat anonymous sounding bend into something that sounds like Brian May? Well, we're going to do it with the vibrato. So let's begin by talking about Brian's pre-bend vibrato. So Brian May has a series, has a number of vibrati that he uses. Some of them are very subtle. So if you listen to like the Killer Queen solo, very, very subtle, very, very gentle vibrato. We're going to talk about a slightly more overt and slightly more dramatic vibrato for this. Now, this is what you might think of as the bending vibrato, I guess. Now, one of the things that always sticks out to me with Brian May's playing is, with Blue Sunlight, angle the pick, un-angle the pick. So de-angle the pick. We're going to flat the pick is what we're looking for. So we're going to flat the pick. It even looks a little more like Brian's hand when you flat the pick, if that makes any sense. So we can kind of tell by looking if that makes any sense to you. So this bending vibrato thing. So something that sticks out to me right away with Brian May's vibrato is it's more of a release vibrato than adding extra pitch on top of the bend. So if we were to take this 10th fret bend and we were to play it here, and then we were to bend some more on top, doesn't really get us to where we're supposed to be. What we're trying to do instead is we're trying to bend up, and then we release this bend just enough that it kind of like gives us that little dip in our sound. But then we return it to the pitch that we've bent up to. Let me just play this in slow motion. So if we play this, that's the sound we're looking for. So let's practice that together. There's our G note for reference. Let's go. Let's do it again. Now let's play it a little faster. And this is where we start to get a little bit more of that Brian May-ism going on. Now, we talked about this with other players, but there is kind of a square character to this vibrato too. It's not a distinct sine wave as we go from one pitch to another. There's a slightly squared off, like kind of movement from pitch A to pitch B, this. And that's kind of what we're looking for here. Now, Brian does this with, again, with his thumb over the top of the neck, because a lot of players of that era did, and it sounds killer. I think the Red Special having such a large neck probably kind of helped with this. But another thing to be kind of aware of with this is Brian May plays with very light strings. So he plays with eights, last time I checked, gold eights, no less, because he is the guitarist by royal appointment. And that is going to help with this, but I'm playing tens. I don't think it's going to make a huge difference. So let's compare, right? Let's compare and contrast. We're going to go back to our lick, and then we'll see what we can do with this this vibrato. Once we've done that, we're going to talk a little bit more about right hand touch again, and specifically the staccato thing that Brian May does a lot of, which sounds really, really cool. And I think, again, is a facet of the playing with a coin. I think that's the sort of thing that, I think that's what's led him to this approach, if that makes any sense. So I'm willing to be wrong on this, but I think that's where it's come from. So we'll go back to our bend. Let's play it together. So if we go with no vibrato, it kind of sounds like nothing. Let's do the Brian vibrato. Sounds a little bit more Brian-tastic. Let's go again. Let's go once more. Here we go. We're gonna go. Really nice. Now, let's talk about the next little portion of this lick where you have this little hammer-on figure. Now, this is where we can start to play things in a really Brian kind of way. So I'm going to break with the phrasing that's in the tech session, and we're going to explore some staccato phrasing, which I think is kind of a very, very key thing when it comes to getting Brian's style down pat, but it's also an expressive thing that kind of plays off against those big, lovely legato bends. So let's talk about what we're playing here. We're going to start with this 10, which is here. It's very difficult for me to do. This 10th fret thing here. We're going to play 10, 8, 10, 8, we'll go down to 7. And then we'll do another little hammer-on from 8 to, sorry, pull-off rather. From 8 to 7. Then we're going to hit 9. It's going to give us this. Now, let's just play that as is, right? If I play that just as a regular common old garden phrase, as any guitarist player would play it, we might get something like this. It sounds fine. There's nothing wrong with it. We're playing the notes, it sounds okay. Let's maybe approach it the way Brian would approach it, where we might get something like this. Now, already, that is getting to be a little more Brian May. We'll talk about why in a second, but let's do one more time. Let's exaggerate that vibrato. Now, there's something in the timing there. There's something in the timing there and something in the touch that makes things, I guess it makes things sound more, well, more authentically Brian. But let's talk about what's actually happening. So the first thing with this is we're not playing these notes joined up. We're playing them staccato. But the way we're getting the staccato is very specific to the way Brian May plays. Now, what do we mean by staccato? Well, staccato is where we play notes that aren't like this, where they're all joined up together. That would be an example of legato phrasing, not to be confused with legato technique on the electric guitar, which is hammer-ons and pull-offs. Like so. Rather, we break the notes up and we make them short. Now, what you'll notice with Brian's playing is that he tends to have this really great contrast between these staccato phrases and these legato notes, and he also tends to put these little silences before the big dramatic bend. So if you get all these kind of, that little pause is a very, very Brian May thing to do. We'll talk more about that bend in just a moment because that's an interesting thing too. But let's see how we're going to get these staccato phrases. Now, the way I think Brian May is getting these, if we take this little 10-8, 10-8-7, like this phrase, I think the way Brian's getting it is I think he's resting the pick on the string, playing the note, and then allowing the pick to rest on the string again. I think it's rest strokes. I think this is where it's coming from. I've gone back to my coin for this. I think that's where this is coming from. Now, the way we're going to get it, like I say, is we're going to play through, we're going to play this 10, and then rest the pick on the string, so it's going nowhere, it's on the string. And then we can get not only that little momentary pause, but we can also get this really important kind of clunk at the start of each one of these notes. Now, it is a little bit better. It is a little bit better with a coin, I will admit this. But with the edge of our clunky pick, with the edge of our chirpy pick, we're getting somewhere. So let's try putting these two phrases together and we'll play them in a fairly anodyne kind of way first, and then we'll compare this bend and this staccato kind of phrasing. We'll compare those and we'll see how we get on. So first of all, fairly straight. It's fine, nothing wrong with it, but it doesn't sound particularly like Brian May, even though we've got the tone going on. Let's try with the Brian vibrato. Now that right away is starting to sound significantly more May-like. So let's go a step further because we've done a little bit of stuff on the staccato thing. Let's reach into that a bit further. So if we have a coin, I want to talk more about the coin and where that's leading the hero of our story with this sort of stuff. So we're going to put the tab away for a moment and we're going to improvise a little bit more with this. So one of the facets of playing with a coin is that you have to be quite close to the string with your fingers to actually make notes, otherwise you can't hold the thing, because these coins are pretty small. Sixpence, pretty small. This 5p, smaller again. But, you know, it's an interesting thing, because what it means is we get these kind of lovely semi-harmonics popping out that we hear loads in Brian's playing. So if we take the same lick... It's very hard for me to do it with a coin, but I'll do it with a pick, and we'll see how we get on. Like, that really puts us in that sort of ballpark. So what I mean by this, we've discussed this before, is a little bit of, like Paul Reed Smith calls it chirping, where you chirp the... You get almost a harmonic on the go, but it's not quite a harmonic on the go. He talks about doing it in the lower strings. I think Brian's doing it on every string, and I think it's out of necessity. I think because when you're playing with the coin, you have to kind of, like, choke down the pick, and you have to give it to that. And I feel like that, in combination with our staccato phrasing, is really going to give us something interesting. Hell of a difference with just the vibrato. Yeah, I agree. Thanks, man. Appreciate it. The vibrato makes a huge difference, right? Huge difference. But the staccato thing is a big part of it, too. Now, let's talk a little bit more about some broader applications with this stuff. So the vibrato is a really, really interesting thing. Because, again, the Brian May vibrato is very, very signature, but there are a few. So he does employ some very subtle vibrato from time to time. Again, the example for this is if you listen to the isolated guitars on Killer Queen, you can hear some really subtle, like, almost not there vibrato. But this big dramatic vibrato is really interesting. So that's a fascinating thing in and of itself. But let's talk a bit more about the application, because the other thing about it is this vibrato hangs below the note rather than going from square on to above the note. And the way Brian achieves this a lot of the time is with a pre-bend. So what do we mean by pre-bend? Well, pre-bend is where we bend our note to the pitch that we're looking for. For example, in this case, we're looking for a B note. We bend to that pitch before we pick it. And again, this is a very Brian May way to play. So if we took a melody that maybe went something like this. If we bent up to that high pitch, that is very much something that Brian May would do, but this pre-bend thing, it just screams Brian May to me, especially when we get a little bit higher on the fretboard. So if we get up to the top and say, for example, we want to take a B up here, not only can we get that lovely singing vibrato, but we can do another cool Brian May trick that we've talked about a little bit before, which is when we bend to this major third, up here, it's sometimes a little bit flat. That is not a bad thing. That's a good thing, right? So there's a phenomenon called the Beatles third, right? It has other names. You might think about it as a just intonated third. What it refers to is it refers to a third, a major third, which is the relationship between the root note and the third note in our chord, in a major chord in this case, where the ratio between these two notes is very simple. Now, that's not something that we get on an in-tune, standard-tuned guitar. This is inherently a compromise. So Western tuning, standard, even temperament tuning is inherently a compromise. This third up here sounds fine, but this third sounds really deliciously Brian May, and it's a little bit flat. I've got a tuner in front of me. Here's the third in tune. Here's the third a little bit flat. I hear that a little flat when I hear Brian playing in the upper register, and I think it sounds utterly tremendous. It's something singers do, and it's basically an effort to make the third sound pleasing rather than be a tuning compromise. So with all of these things in mind, I want to jam with you guys back and forward. So I want to show you the chord progression we're dealing with here, and we're going to talk about one more Brian May trick. And this is more of a songwriting trick, but generally speaking, something I hear quite a lot in Brian's playing is I'll hear this move where he'll modulate to a fifth away. So what I mean by that is we're in the key of G major. You'll often find Brian will modulate momentarily to D major. Now, you might think about this as going between G major and G Lydian. That's a fun way to think about it. But what we're doing here in our chord progression is we're taking the chords of G, D, and E minor, and then we're introducing an A, which is the fifth of D major. Now, this brings with it a C sharp note. So ways you might think about getting this, if we started with a G minor pentatonic, sorry, G major pentatonic, which is the same as E minor, you may think about including F sharps and Cs over all the chords that aren't A. But when it comes to the A, we might change that to a C sharp. If you want some help with this, by the way, we've got a whole course on the subject called Mastering Modes Part 1. But let me show you what I'm dealing with here, right? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to play in G. There's our A. A. Now, throwing some more stuff in there. Chris Brown says the A major stops being completely Freebird. I am hearing so much Freebird. I absolutely agree. Rick Elliott says, when you choke up, choking up with the pick makes a huge difference for sure. So anyway, let's jam on this, right? So what we're looking for here is we're looking for G major over the first two chords, then we'll go to D major over the second two chords. Things we're going to play with. We're going to play with the idea of this Brian May vibrato, where we pre-bend to the note and we let it sing just a little below the note, like this. We're also going to play with the idea of contrasting some staccato with some legato phrasing. What I mean by that is this. What's interesting with this is I also hear that same idea an awful lot in Paul Gilbert's guitar playing. Just guess it shows you the cross-pollination of guitar playing ideas. So we're playing with pre-bends, we're playing with the idea of using a flat pick attack with a lot of finger choke, a lot of going on. A chirpy pick really helps. I'm not going to reach for the coin because the coin is a pain in the bum to play with. But it's definitely the most authentic way to play. You'll notice at no point, by the way, have we discussed AC30s treble boosters or Burns trisonic pickups in today's session. Just throwing that out there. It is important stuff if you want the most authentic Brian tone, but the touch and the playing, way more important. There's a famous quote of, I think it was Eddie Van Halen, when he finally got to play Brian May's guitar rig and he plugged into it and he went, "It just sounds like me." And it's like, well, yeah, of course it does. You know, you just missing a Brian is what it is. So anyway, not that Eddie Van Halen through Brian May's guitar rig would have sounded anything less than spectacular, because it's Eddie Van Halen, holy shit. Anyway, let's jam on this. I'm gonna play a little bit and then you guys are gonna play with me. We're gonna start in the key of G major. We're gonna move to the key of D major. If you just want to stick to G major pentatonic, that is absolutely fine, absolutely fine. The other thing that you can do is you can play when you can play C's over the first two chords, include C sharps over the second two chords. That's going to work. Let me show you. Close-up cam. C's over the first two notes. First two chords. C sharps here. So on and so forth, right? So I'm going to take a pass. You're going to take a pass. We're going to see how, Brian, we can make it. Can you just play and hang on the target? I'm going to answer this question a little bit. That's a real good shout. We'll come back to that. Okay, here we go. My turn. I'm going to play. So it's G major here, we're including C notes, if that's something you want to do. We're gonna modulate to A major. Sorry, D major, my mistake. Why am I saying A major? It's D major. It's D major. A major would probably work too. My turn. Your turn. Here we go, including C sharp notes here. It's that little modulation fifth away. There was a question about this that I'm going to answer a bit later on. I'll go once again. Your turn. Again, remember that staccato phrasing is something we're looking for. And we're going to contrast that with the legato phrasing. That lovely clunk. I'm going to go again. Your turn. That vibrato is really important. Let the vibrato hang just below the note. So it's not going on top of the note, it's hanging underneath. We're gonna take one more pass each. You can have the last word. So I'm gonna go like this. Your turn. To do. All right, we're gonna leave that there. So hopefully guys, this has been a useful insight into some of Brian May's expressive qualities. Again, there's so much we could talk about. We could talk about the rig, we could talk about the AC30, where I'm getting the tone from, all that sort of thing, why the tone is so dry compared to my usual jam, which is like all the reverb and all the delay. And we know Brian likes a bit of delay too, but we're going for that early Brian tone, that early Brian studio tone, which is bone dry. Apart from a little bit of splashback into the mics from the room, because man, Brian played loud, and still does play loud. If you ever had an AC30 cranked, you'll know what I'm talking about. You'd be like, 30 watts? Whatever. No, for real. Like, these things are really loud. So anyway, we've got some great questions coming in, but we're going to answer some more questions when we come back. So we'll be answering whatever questions you have. We already have one about writing Brian May style harmonies, which is an interesting shout. We'll have a think about how I can demonstrate that. I'm sure there's a few ways we can do it. I have some thoughts, but, you know, we'll discuss that in a second. But if you have other questions, drop your questions in the comments below. In the meantime, I want to take a moment and show you this. If you've been having some difficulty with the expressiveness of your guitar playing, we have a course for you. The course is Expressive Techniques Part 1. We also have a course on modes, where you can learn about all that modulation stuff that we've just done. So if you're a little bit confused about that, you can check out Mastering Modes Part 1, which is available as part of your GI Plus membership. URL is currently covered by this banner. It'll be back in a second. But this is Expressive Techniques Part 1, which is going to show you all of the stuff we've been talking about today and more.
Oh.
Hi guys, Nick Jennison with Guitar Interactive and GI Plus. Does your playing sound like this? When really you'd like it to sound like this. Now, the difference between these two examples are not the notes that are being played, but rather the way the notes are being played. I'm sure you've heard this before. Guitar players will say to you, it's not what you play, it's how you play it. And when it comes to creating interesting, emotive, and musical sounding guitar lines, that is very much the case. And in this course, Expressive Techniques Part 1, we aim to equip you with the tools to sound more musical, more emotive, more interesting, and ultimately more expressive on the guitar. And we are going to do this by exploring the three principal left-hand expressive techniques, which are slides, bends, and vibrato. I'm going to show you the mechanics of these techniques and how you can execute them cleanly, efficiently, and reliably. I'll also give you some exercises to help develop these techniques. And we're also going to discuss some musical applications, how you might use these techniques in your own playing. We're going to go into great depth with that stuff. And I'm also going to give you a solo study, a piece of music I've prepared. And I'm going to encourage you and kind of guide you through the process of applying expression to an otherwise expressionless and bare sounding piece of guitar playing. So at the end of this course, you are going to be able to take otherwise uninteresting and fairly dry pieces of music and turn them into expressive, colorful, musical lines. And you're also going to be able to take this and apply it to your own playing or to other people's music that maybe you're playing and you want to express in your own way. This is Expressive Techniques Part 1. My name is Nick Jennison for Guitar Interactive GI Plus. I hope you'll join me. I will see you in there. So that's Expressive Techniques Part 1. We've had a load of success stories with that already. So if you're interested in checking that out, you can do it right here. GI Plus, it says so up here. This is where you go to get more guitar lessons like this one. You can also get the tech session that we looked at today in its fullness as part of your GI Plus membership. So if you want a real deep dive on the Brian May tone, the Brian May everything from somebody who's actually played with Brian, then that's the place to go get it. Anyway, in the meantime, let's check in with you guys because we're going to answer some of your questions. We have some real good ones come in so far. I've got some lovely comments as well. I've got to say, thanks so much for these guys. I really appreciate it. Says Roberto Alves, easy for me to say. Says it's impressive how Nick plays, talks, and doesn't look to the guitar, but it still sounds great and perfect. Perfect. Do you know what it is, man? I think this is because I'm a singer and oftentimes I don't get to look at the guitar. I have to look forward because I'm trying to talk to an audience or engage an audience. And I've taught for a very long time as well. So I used to teach in person to rooms full of like children or teenagers. And you've got to like, they're like herding cats. They were lovely. They were great students. But like, man, trying to keep them in line, trying to keep them engaged, you just got to keep talking. So maybe it's a skill that I picked up there. Who knows? Anyway, another really lovely comment. I've got to say, a second note is said, Nick, some of the best vibrato. Nick, you have some of the best vibrato I've heard for real. I'd love to hear you do some Paul Kossoff sometimes. Oh, man, that's really kind of you. Thank you so much. Maybe we will do a Kossoff one. Who knows? We've got a Kossoff tech session, so maybe we'll do a Kossoff stream. ask and you shall receive. So more questions anyway. I want to flag up some of these. Rick Elliott says, very violin-like quality to that sound. Nice phrase. And thanks, man. I appreciate that. Very, very kind. Rick Elliott's got a great question too. He says, when you choke up on the pick, do you find harmonic sounding by the muting occurs when your fingers mute the strings? For real, they absolutely do. You get a little bit of a chirp from the mute depending upon what your pick is made of. So with our coin, for example, we get a real pronounced chirp. Whereas with my Tortex pick that I normally play with, I use this pick because it doesn't chirp, and that's why I like it. But it's not terribly Brian. That chirp is a very, very Brian thing. So for this, I'm using this strange pick, which is still tripping me up a little bit because it's a bit bigger and a bit bulkier than the one I normally used to. But, you know, it can work. It can absolutely work. So anyway, let's get into some more questions. I promised I would answer this one from Kellen. I don't know. But hey, man, first time commenter, thanks for joining us. I do appreciate it. We love it when people come join us for the first time. I'd love to answer your question. Any advice on how to write Brian May-like guitar harmonies? For sure. I've had to do this a bunch of times. Anytime I'm demoing something AC30-like, especially the ones for Victory we did recently, we did the V1 Copper. And like, I just had to play some Brian stuff because Brian stuff is expected when you play an AC30, even though there is way more to the tone than AC30 alone. But what I like to think about with Brian May harmonies is a lot of times it's a three guitar stack of diatonic major harmonies. Now, what do we mean by that? So let's take the example of a run in G major, right? So let's take the idea of a run that maybe goes like this. So what that might look like is that might be, I'll just teach you this real quick. We're going to start on G and we're going to play the notes of G major, which are G, A, B, C, D, E, F sharp, and G. We'll start with this G. We'll go G, A, G, F sharp, which is something that is referred to in classical music as a turn. And it's this cool little coded thing that Brian will put in his playing that, you know, kind of like harkens back to, I guess, like oldie-worldy kind of stuff, almost, I guess. I don't know, it's like a... it's hard to describe, but it's like a courtly sort of sound that I think really kind of like... It really adds to Queen's aesthetic with that sort of thing. But anyway, so we have a little turn. And then we're going to run straight up the scale. And once we're there, we'll go up to an A, and then we'll bend our way up to a B. Now, if you have a guitar, we'll see how we can demonstrate this. I want you to play this with me, because I'll be playing a harmony in just a moment. So the line is going to go, and then we'll count it off. It'll go 1, 2, 3, 4. And we'll slow down a little bit towards the end. So we've got that. Let's play it together. 1, 2, 3, 4. Hopefully you got that, because we're going to play some harmonies. Now, the harmonies in question are going to be largely diatonic. So what I mean by that is they are going to follow the same series of notes, which is G, A, B, C, D, E, F sharp, and G, but they're going to start somewhere else in the scale. So they're going to start, in this case, we're going to start our higher harmony on a B note, which will give us this. A lot of fun. Now, if we play this together, if you play, I'll play. Let's do it together. Ready? Oh, 1, 2, 3, 4. I need you to play, because otherwise you won't hear it. Ready? Oh, 1, 2, 3. Now, the important thing with this is not only is the harmony diatonic, i.e. the first harmony starts on G and goes G, A, B, C, D, E, F sharp, G, A, B. The second harmony starts on B but plays all the same notes, so it's B, C, D, E, F sharp, G, A, B, C, D. It's all the same, like kind of, it moves in the same contour through the scale, let's say. So that's kind of the way to think about that. But also, the other thing with this, it's important to keep the phrasing the same. So that's something Brian will do really, really well, is he'll phrase in such a way that his harmonies are really, really tight. So if he does a pre-bend here to get those last notes, the same will be here. One last cool little trick, right? We're going to show you one more, which is a fun thing that Brian might do sometimes when approaching the fifth. So if we have the same idea here, we can start here on an E, which is two notes down in our scale, but we might get something like this. Like that. But another fun thing you'll hear sometimes is you'll sometimes hear an approach which is like a semitone approach. So I'm trying to think how to demonstrate that. Maybe that's another story for another day. Maybe we need to go a little deeper on that because I can't really show you without you playing. But let's see if we can do some of this together. So if you play this, I'm going to show you the harmony below and the harmony above. Let's see if we can make that work. Ready? So you're going to play this one. Ready? A one, two, three, four. Ready? Let's do it again. A one, two, three, four. Now, that would be an example. Of course, we could have used a simpler lick than that, but that's a really fun lick because it demonstrates the importance of getting the phrasing right. Of course, what we really need is we need three guitars to do this because when you hear Brian's guitar harmonies, they tend to be in three parts rather than in two parts. Sometimes two parts, but that real signature Brian May sound is in three parts, I think. Hank Staines says, can you just play and hang on the target notes with a bit of vibrato as the chord changes, i.e. root third or fifth? Certainly can. Let's do it on some combination of those. So the first few chords are G, D, E minor, and then we have some kind of seventh chord going on there. I'm not sure entirely what it is. I should look it up. Then we have A going to a D. The way I'm going to hit these is I'm going to hit the third on the first chord, and then over the D, I'll hit the fifth. Over the E minor, I'll hit the third, just because it gives us a little bit of voice leading. Over the A, I'm going to hit the third, and over the D, I'll hit the root, which is going to be a C sharp to D movement. Just keeps things nice and tidy. Let me show you what I'm talking about here. So this would be an example of this. Here are some chord tones with vibrato just hanging on them. Interesting about this is if we prioritize hitting thirds on those really strong chords, we just get this really cool Brian May sound. It's almost like Brian May is like, it's almost like he's playing a lot of thirds because they sound super melodic and they're not like really, it's not to say that every chord Brian's going to play a third over the top of it, but it definitely gives you that vibe. Anyway, second note has a really interesting question. It says, do you consider the guitar journey as a series of instant clicks in the thinking or just a long, slow, steady progression? I actually think it's both. And I think it depends how zoomed in you are. So if you are looking at your guitar playing on like a oh, I don't know, let's say a month-by-month basis, it will look like a very jagged progression. It will look like you'll go, let's start this side. Let's see if I can make this so you guys can visualize it. So starting here, finishing up here. It looked like you go, nothing. Click. Oh, yeah, amazing. Oh, I'm a bit worse now. And then along you go, and then you go, click. And then, oh, I'm much worse now. I had a bad month or something. And then click. I think it looks like that in the short term, in measured in months. But when you measure it over the course of 20 plus years, it's going to zoom out and look like this. It's going to look like a jagged but slow upward progression. Hopefully that makes sense, but that's how I kind of think about it. So it's going to trend up over time, but if you zoom in too close, it's going to look jagged and it's going to look kind of like, what the hell's going on? It's a series of clicks. So I think the interesting thing with this is... The interesting thing with this, again, is it depends how tightly zoomed in you are on the process. So if you trust the process and you just kind of, you know, you trust that with practice and with improvement, you're going to get better over time, which you have. You know, if you look back at your guitar playing career, you've progressed significantly since the first time you played, I would imagine. But I think that's the way to think about it. So trust the process. Know that you are going to... experience gradual progression, slow gradual progression over the long term and series of clicks over the short term. Hopefully that makes sense. It was a bit rambly, but hopefully it makes sense. Anyway, we got some other questions, right? I like the trailer says, does this sound like you're playing? My answer is no, because yours was in tune. Oh no. Ironically, the one that sounded better towards the end was less in tune, but that's the way it goes. So anyway, Nick used a looper. I wish I'd known. You know what it is? Like, loopers are my nemesis, right? Have a looper down here. I can never get them in time. It's just like a total blind spot for me. I need to spend more time with them. I'm going to actually answer this question, right? This is our friend Brassneck says, why copy others? Do your own stuff. Don't listen to this. Well, that's very pleasant of you. But let's answer this question because it's an important question, right? So why copy stuff that's been done 40 years ago? Right, absolute waste of time, he says. Copying stuff from 40 years ago, do something your own mind created. Well, here's the thing, man. Like, you are not a unique. Every idea that you ever come up with is a combination of your own creativity and things that you have heard at some point over your career or some point over your time on the earth, let's say, right? So, everything you listen to in one way or another is going to influence you either to kind of take it and make it part of your being or to maybe take it and reject it and go, this is not part of my being. So an example of this might be, I'm not necessarily a huge fan of, let's say, some 90s pop music. I grew up in the 90s, didn't really do it for me. So I took a listen to it and went, cool, I'm going to reject that. But I've made the decision that I've listened to it, I've acknowledged that it exists. I don't live in a vacuum, neither do you. So I've made that point and I've gone, no, not interested in that. So in terms of copying stuff that went on 40 years ago, so we can benefit a great deal and improve our own creative vocabulary by acknowledging the work of great masters that have come before us. It's the same in any creative endeavor, like in literary endeavors. It's important to be aware of and draw influence from, where it's appropriate, the great literary masters. The same is true for anybody who's maybe painting, let's say, or if you're, you're an artist, you're trying to, develop a new art style, let's say. Let's say you're the first abstract artist. Well, you still have an acknowledgement of the stuff that went before, even if you acknowledge it only so that you can consciously reject it. So that's kind of why. I think that's why. I understand that, you know, dude's just here to kind of cause a bit of a mess, but it's an important question. So there you go. That's why. That is why. Also, it's fun. I like Brian May, so why wouldn't you? Anyway, there we go. So I'm going to see if we've got one more question. Snakebite says, Brian May is a player that's obviously spent a lot of time thinking about tone. For sure. I agree. I absolutely agree. I think Brian May spent more time... more time thinking about his touch than his tone because of the rudimentary tools that he has available to him. And he hasn't really branched out from those tools. He's taken a sonic palette, which is very broad, by the way, but that's more to do with the way that he uses it. And he's gone, yeah, I'm going to play with just this. I'm not going to plug into a Marshall. I'm not going to plug into a Mesa Boogie, and I'm not going to plug into a quad cortex like the one I have down here, which is killer, by the way, just throwing that out there. I'm not plugged into that today. But I think he's taken the limited tonal palette and gone, I'm going to do loads of stuff with this, which is cool. I think that's important. It's an important lesson that we can learn. Important lesson that we learn. So anyway, guys, listen, I someone imitates EVH. I got to flag you up with this. Someone imitates EVH, right? That's not next week. It's coming in 2 weeks' time. I'm checking my calendar. 2 weeks' time, we're doing EVH. Right, so that is going to be our, I guess it's going to be our last one before Christmas. So we'll be doing EVH at some point, but our next one is going to be Gary Moore. So if you guys are Gary Moore fans, man, stick around, because it's going to be Gary Moore for a whole hour next week. So anyway, listen, right, we have answered the question, why copy folks? I think it's important, right? I think it's important to give people like this, even if they're just here to stir up trouble, I think it's important to give them a genuine answer, if there is a genuine answer, because even if they might not learn from the experience, we can, right? So I think that's the reason why we copy other people. I don't know. One of those things. Maybe I'm completely wrong. I'm completely wrong about lots of things, but who knows? Anyway, listen, guys, thank you so much for having me. My name's Nick Jennison from Guitar Interactive. This has been a look into the expressive techniques of Brian May. We are going to be looking at Gary Moore next week, Eddie Van Halen the week after. Make sure you're subscribed to our YouTube channel so we can notify you when we are about to go live. It's 8 p.m. every Monday. In the meantime, let's jam out on some more Brian ideas. If you want to play along with me, it's G major over the first two bars, D major. I'll get this right one day. D major over the second two bars. Let's play. My name's Nick Jennison from Guitar Interactive. See you next week. Play Freebird over this. My name's Nick Jennison. See you next week. My name's Nick Jennison, and it's a pleasure to introduce to you GI Plus, the brand new lesson platform brought to you by Guitar Interactive. We've assembled a team of the best players and educators in the world to bring you exclusive lessons covering everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Or maybe country's more your bag? Well, how about a full-length exclusive country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from fusion maestro Tom Quayle. Or maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful? Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done? Or perhaps you want to learn the secrets of the masters? Well, members get access to over 60 feature-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Carlton, Tosin Abasi, Paul Gilbert, and many more. You get all this along with exclusive live webinars, free backing tracks, competitions, and so much more. So what are you waiting for? Sign up for GI Plus today.